Here, let me put it to you this way, Michael. What is Mimic giving you for all of that work that it's doing in building dependency trees and you know, running Prim's algorithm and finding maximum spanning trees?
I'm going to say structure because that's the word that you've been using repeatedly.
You get structure. And another way of thinking about structure in this case is you're getting information. You get a lot more information because you get structure. You get a lot more information per iteration as well. So that's the price you're paying. You're getting more information every single time you do an iteration at the cost of building these maximum spanning trees or whatever it is you're doing in estimating your probability distribution. So why would it be worth it to do that? What's the other source of expense?
Well, so, all right, so there's all this computation within an iteration, but what it's trying to find inputs that have high scores, and so you do have to compute the scores for all those inputs. So the fitness calculation is really important.
Right. So Mimic tends to work really well when the cost of evaluating your fitness function is high. So it's really important that I only have to take 100 iterations if every single time I look at a fitness function and try to compute it for some particular X, I pay some huge cost in time.
Well, have you told us how many function evaluations there are in an iteration? Because it seems like it could be a lot in Mimic.
Well, you get one basically for every sample you generate.
Yeah, and so I guess you can compare iterations, but you can also compare samples.
Right, so that would depend upon how many samples you feel like you need to generate. And of course, you can be very clever because remember, theta will generate a bunch of samples for theta plus one. Mm. So if you keep track of the ones that values you've seen before, you don't have to recompute them. So it's actually pretty hard to know exactly what that's going to be. But let's imagine that at every iteration, you generate 100 samples. So at most, you're going to have to evaluate f of x 100 times. So Mimic is still a win over something else if the number of iterations that it takes is more than 100 times fewer.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah.
So can you think of functions, fitness functions, real fitness functions that might actually be expensive to compute?
Well, yeah, sure. I mean, a lot of the stuff that is important is like that. So if you're trying to design a rocket ship or something like that, that a fitness evaluation is doing a detailed simulation of how it performs. And that could be a very costly thing.
Right. Actually, that's a good example because Mimic has been used for things like antenna design. It's been used for things like designing exactly where you would put a rocket in order to minimize fuel costs, sending it to the moon. These sorts of things where the cost really is in evaluating some particular configuration where you have to run a simulation or you have to compute a huge number of values of equations and so on and so forth in order to figure out the answer. Another case where it comes up a lot is where your evaluation function, your fitness function, involves human beings.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
Where you generate something and you ask a human, how does this look? Or does this do what you want it to do? Because humans, it turns out, are really slow.
Yeah, they're not measured in megaflops.
That's right. So you end up with cases where fitness functions are expensive. Something like this becomes a big win. And that's a general point to make, though, that when you're looking at all of these different algorithms, these different models, for everything that we've been doing, both for unsupervised learning and earlier for supervised learning, a lot of times your trade-off is not just in terms of whether you're going to overfit or not. It's whether it's worth the price you need to pay in terms of either space or time complexity to go with one model versus the other. We've been talking about it in terms of sample complexity, but there's still time complexity and space complexity to worry about.
Cool. I get it.
Okay, cool. So normally what we would do next is we would say, what have we learned? But I actually kind of think we just did that.
Indeed.
So in fact, let me do something about that.